This morning we're going to continue our teachings on the Cether of Elyon, or the hiding place of the Most High God. I told you that the 22nd reason why we need to spend time with God is for us to stay long enough in His presence for the fear of man to dissolve and to leave. We were looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 20, please. Where we looked at the life of this man. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And we read about a man called Jehoshaphat. Isn't it amazing that Jehoshaphat, in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, would be able to stand the smell and the stench of war, only to reap the blessing or the baraka of God in such an extraordinary way? You heard our brother just speak about an embarrassing figure of 1.3 crores, 1.5 crores in 3 months. I don't know how to say this. Baraka that God gave His people. We don't know quite well the word to use. If it's embarrassing to spend that much in 3 months, I don't know how much of embarrassment this is in 3 days. For you to have not enough strength to get the wealth back home with you, that you have to drag them. And I want you to understand that this place is not an ordinary place. You have houses named Baraka. I don't hear you. But most people, when they see Baraka, they don't understand that to some it was death. That's what harvest is. To some it was death. To some it was blessing. To some it was destruction. To some it was immense prosperity. Don't ever forget Baraka. When you see it on walls, the names of houses, understand that on the one side God is honoring righteous seed. On the other side He was putting to shame unrighteous seed. Righteous seed was sown many, many years ago, centuries ago, by Israel, in obedience to God. That harvest came in the time of Jehoshaphat. That's why when you talk about seed time and harvest, you never know how seed works. Sometimes seed you sow today can bear fruit the next day or even the same day. Sometimes there's a time period of waiting, 1 month, 6 months, 3 years, 12 years. It doesn't matter. But someday the harvest comes. So if you can stand the stench of war long enough, you can enjoy the fruitfulness of the baraka of God, the blessing of God. It will come. And it will come the way God says it will come, with rejoicing, with the fear of the Lord, taking precedence over the fear of man. So when you get back to the place of your stay, there will be rest round about you. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about His people. So you will see there is a wholesomeness of shalom that you experience. Rest. You look at restless people. Restless people have no peace on the inside of them. You look at people who are filled with peace. To tell you the truth, it will appear like they are not in a hurry. Because faith is not in a hurry. Faith believes the Lord. Trusts the Lord. Can you imagine that people were worshipping the Lord while the enemy was killing himself? 1 million soldiers. I want you to write it down if you were not here last week. 1 million soldiers killed themselves. This is the biggest incident, I believe, of suicide ever recorded, where 1 million soldiers killed themselves. They killed each other and then they started killing themselves. Till there were about 1 million dead bodies lying there. And in the midst of that, when the children of Israel came to the watchtower, the Bible says, they looked and saw dead bodies. But beyond the dead bodies, they saw something else. The spoils of war. And I want you to have your eyesight tuned in to what God shows you. To many people, all that they see is dead bodies. All that they see is death, uselessness, non-productivity. But if you look beyond that, you begin to see the blessing of God, the barakah of God, the spoils of war. And if you ask me, the blessing that comes from being a praiser and a worshiper. You must know how to worship the Lord. You must know how to praise the Lord. You must know what it is to wait upon God. You look at anyone who waits upon God, that person is setting himself up for divine appointment. You look at an unprayerful soul, that person is actually setting themselves up for disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. So to one, it is divine appointments. Every prayer time is divine appointments. You're keeping your appointment with God. You're rushing in sometimes to keep your appointment with God. You look at someone who never prays, he is a disappointed individual. Someone gave us a wall hanging one time which says, I rushed into the day. I had no time to pray. What happened through the day was utter fruitlessness, no blessing. Then I wondered why. It was because I was too busy to pray. There are about 4 or 5 beautiful paragraphs to that thought-provoking poem. But finally it says, I got up one day. I met the Lord. I knew if the day was going to be fruitful, I had to find time to pray. I had to make time to pray. I had to spend time with God. Divine appointments are always, always what man prepares himself for. I want you to understand that miracles are always very established seasons in which God meets his people who are prepared for those seasons. You look at an unprepared man, the book of Proverbs tells us about a son who causes shame to the family. Why does he cause shame to the family? It's because in times of harvest, the man is sleeping. He is not out where he should be. Everybody else is bringing the harvest in except this individual. Somehow this individual doesn't see the harvest. He doesn't understand the time of the harvest. He is at rest when everyone else is working. So I want you to pay attention to this very, very carefully. When you stay long enough with God, the fear of God begins to take a hold of you. The fear of God gives you the wisdom of God and the long-sightedness of God as well. You must be able to see beyond what you see now. If you only see what you see now, you're a short-sighted individual. You haven't, as yet, spent time with God. You're too busy for God to hear his instructions. And that's the reason why you will not see the fulfillment of the blessings of God in your life. But never forget what barakah means. Barakah means harvest, blessing. Righteous seed were blessed with victory in battle and untold wealth and riches. There was great joy in the camp. So when you talk about joy of the Lord, remember the joy of the Lord must be translated from intangible things to even tangible things. Sometimes people think joy, you can't actually explain it. It's from the spirit, and they give out so many things, but you must understand joy in the spirit is also seen in productivity in the natural world. There was great rejoicing. God caused his people to have great rejoicing. You look at all the seasons in time when Israel rejoiced, you will always find that they were blessed with material prosperity as well in those seasons of joy. Never was poverty hyped. Never was poverty the order of the day when God said there was great rejoicing. Always it was a rejoicing in the spirit and a tangible blessing in the natural world as well. So I want you to prepare for it. Unless you're a prepared vessel, you will not see it happen. Let me put it like that. God willing, if the Lord will help me teach on the principles of the harvest, the hundredfold harvest, it'll surprise you. But it shouldn't. Because if it is from God, it'll come to pass. Can I have an amen? If it is from God, it'll come to pass. Now, I want you to see another example from the same book, this book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 31. I want you to see verses 20 and 21. And thus did Hezekiah throughout all Judah, and wrought that which was good and right and truth before the Lord his God. And in every work that he began in the service of the house of God and in the law and in the commandments to seek his God, he did it with all his heart and prospered. The fear of God was so strong in this man's life, Hezekiah, that in chapter 31 of 2 Chronicles in verse 1, the Bible tells us that what he did was an amazing act of faith. He destroyed the images, cut down the groves and the altars out of all Judah and Benjamin. That means he was not frightened of people. The fear of God in his heart made him to do what he did. Remember, every king longs to be popular with his people. I want you to write it down. Every king wants to be popular with his people. The downfall of Saul was because he was frightened of his people. He wanted his people to long and love him in such a way that the fear of God would be something he would push to backseat. He would do what they wanted him to do. Not Hezekiah. Hezekiah wanted to be God's king to God's people. You're God's appointed manager to a God-given staff. You're a God-given blessing to wherever you are placed, to the ones under you. And I'm specifically speaking about this because this man believed God's blessing on his life was far better than people's opinion of him. So even though there were vast numbers of people who worshipped idols, the first thing he did was, in his reign, he did away with it completely. He broke idols. And instead he appointed people to worship the Lord and to praise the Lord. From morning to evening. Now, because he did it with all his heart and he sought the face of God, the Bible says he prospered. I wanted to highlight the word prospered. The word prospered is not a bad word. Today you have people who say, well, we don't want that prosperity message. We don't want that prosperity gospel. Well, if you ask me, the Bible is a prosperity book. I don't hear you. The Bible is a prosperity book. The Bible doesn't talk of lack one place, except when sin entered the scene. When you talk about God in creation, He's a God of plenty. He's seen creating fish and birds and plants and everything and just putting two people there in Eden. Certainly, too much for two people to consume at one time. But God was not looking at just two people. He was looking way beyond two people. He was looking at generations who would come who would enjoy His blessing. And to tell you the truth, if they had not sinned, the first man and the first woman, Eden would have been big enough for everyone who was born to them to inhabit and to enjoy. There wouldn't have been any lack one bit. The absence of hunger, the absence of sickness and disease, the absence of lack, the absence of desperation and anguish would have been such great blessing to the descendants of the first man and the woman that Eden would have been a place of great plenteousness. Now, as the man prospered, in verse 32, the attack came. And that's why we need to be careful about not turning the dial down on our prayer life when prosperity comes. That's the common mistake most people do. The moment they start prospering and the moment they start getting a lot of things going good in their life, somehow prayer time takes a dip in their lives. And this is a warning to us because you see it all over the scriptures. Whether it was Asa, or whether it was Jehoshaphat, or whether it is King Hezekiah, the moment prosperity began to be known by the people of the world, the attack came. After these things, the establishment thereof, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came and entered into Judah and encamped against the fenced cities and thought to win them for himself. The devil always wants your prosperity. Don't forget that. Don't give him an inroad into your bank account. Don't let him touch your purse. Don't let him touch your health. Don't let him touch your wealth. Because every time you enjoy it, the devil wants it. He wants to claim it for himself. So I want you to circle the word, he thought to win it for himself. Win them for himself. So the devil understands there is a war that is on. There will be a struggle. But at the end of it, he wants to win. The good news is God already sees you as winner, not loser. And when Hezekiah saw that Sennacherib was come and that he was purposed to fight against Jerusalem, he took counsel with his princes and his mighty men to stop the waters of the fountains, which were without the city, and they did help him. There were gathered much people together who stopped all the fountains and the brooks, or the brook that ran through the midst of the land, saying, "Why should the kings of Assyria come and find much water?" I want you to see something here. Although this is historically true and documented, you must go beyond the historical truth to see what the man did. He would not give sustenance for the enemy from the blessing he enjoyed. I want you to write it down. He would not give sustenance for the enemy from the blessing he enjoyed. When you see an attack on your finances, don't give sustenance to the enemy from the blessing that God has given you. Don't continue to sow into bad soil. Sow into good soil. Don't let the waters run in an uncontrollable way where the enemy can come and draw sustenance from it. That is your foolishness if you do it. I want you to write what I'm saying. Because many people in the church are real foolish. They don't understand the wisdom of God one bit. Last week I asked people to stretch out their hands before the Lord, who would every day read the book of Proverbs. Surprisingly, in all the three worship services since the time I last asked it, there were many people who were added to the ones who initially raised up their hands who are reading the book of Proverbs. Very encouraging. But it'll be a tremendous blessing if an entire church does it. Can I have an amen? There are most people who never read the book of Proverbs. Why? Because they think it is some sayings of Solomon. They don't understand that the wisdom of God is so linked to the future that they must have and enjoy. That unless they read from the wisdom of God, which is found in the book of Proverbs, chances are you can predict their future very, very clearly. Now look at this man. What did he do? He would not give sustenance to the enemy from the blessing he had. He stopped the waters that ran through the midst of the land. Also, he strengthened himself and built up all the wall that was broken. I want you to highlight that, please. When the wall is broken, the enemy will come. Can I have an amen, please? When the wall is broken, the enemy will come. When the hedge is broken, the serpent strikes. If you allow the enemy to strike your finances, he will strike your finances. Don't even wonder whether he'll strike. If you give him a chance, he will do it. If you're not careful, he will get you. I want you to mark this down. He built up all the wall that was broken. You know, in almost everyone's lives, there are walls that are broken. They must be rebuilt. This is the year of rebuilding. Can I have an amen? This is the year of rebuilding. Some of you think I'm talking some story. I am not talking some story. I am not talking stories. I am talking reality. And if you understand the way God works, you will begin to see the wisdom of God in what I am saying. This is a year of restoration, rebuilding, re-reward and renewal. All of them go together. All go together. If the wall is broken, the enemy will strike. It can be in health, it can be in wealth, it can be in prosperity, it can be in peace, it can be in anything. And raised it up to the towers, and another wall without, and repaired Milo in the city of David, and made darts and shields in abundance. I want you to mark these words. That's why I want you to have your Bible with you. What did he make? He made in abundance military arsenal. He did what he had to do. He didn't sit and say, well, let the enemy come, then we will see. He already knew the enemy had come. No, he did what he knew to do in the natural. That's why you must do what you must do in the natural, but you must also do what you have to do in the spiritual. Some people do everything in the natural but never do anything in the spiritual. That's the biggest mistake they do. And they end up never living by God's standard of blessing. Like the Lord inspired someone to talk about called the blessing of Eden. They wouldn't want to spend time receiving the blessing of Eden in their lives. They'll rather live by the Babylonian system of blessing, the world way. Do it, reap the blessings of it. Well, that's a limited way of getting blessing, my friends. If you do something in the spiritual, you must do something in the natural. If you do something in the natural, you must do what you have to do in the spiritual as well. Now, follow carefully. And he set captains of war over the people and gathered them together to him in the street of the gate of the city and spake comfortably to them, saying, be strong and courageous. Be not afraid, nor dismayed for the king of Assyria, nor for all the multitude that is with him. For there is more with us than with him. I want you to write this down, please. You will never rise above your confession. You will never rise above your confession. If you are always given to confessing lack, you will see lack get the better of you. I don't have. I really don't have. But sometimes you do have, and you're lying about I don't have. You must have enough strength to speak right in times of pressure. This man was speaking right words. That's why I want you to write it down. You will never rise above your confession. He knew that the enemy was strong. Sennacherib had a good track record. Everywhere he went, he won. I'm going to talk about that a little later. Everywhere he went, he won. But the place where he came up against, he lost. What made this attack of Sennacherib a shame to the man? Prayer, my friends. Not the shields of abundance, not the darts of abundance, prayer. Be strong, be courageous, be not afraid, not dismayed. For there be more with us than with him. You must understand that by the very revelation of God to us, Israel was never known to be a very big nation. The very reason God showed tremendous love upon Israel was because they were few people. And for a man to be seeing the enemy face to face, just encamped over against the city and the city walls, for him to see the tremendous arsenal ranged against them, the Syrian army, their forces, their equipment, and their track record. Wherever he went, he won. Wherever he went, he won. Must have taken all the spiritual guts of this man to say, there are more with us than with him. Why? Because his eyesight was an eyesight that transcended the natural world. If you're always given to seeing only natural things, you will never see the provision of God or the protection of God. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. Even for fun, don't groan. People are listening carefully to your words, especially if you're in position of a leadership situation where you are the leader. You must know what words you speak. When the pressure is on, if you sit and exclaim aloud, where your people hear wrong confession, sooner or later it's going to get them. That's why you must know what you speak. You must know what to speak before the people. You must know what to speak before your God. Let's see, please. After this did Sennacherib, king of Assyria, send his servants to Jerusalem. But he himself laid siege against Lachish and all his power with him unto Hezekiah, king of Judah, and unto all Judah, that were at Jerusalem, saying, Thus saith Sennacherib, king of Assyria, whereon do you trust that you abide in the siege in Jerusalem? Doth not Hezekiah persuade you to give over yourselves to die by famine and by thirst, saying, The Lord our God shall deliver us out of the hand of the king of Assyria? I want you to see this, because this is an imagery that you can just imagine from the sights we saw on television not too long ago. One man kept people with him, thinking he could use them as human shields against a nation that was fighting to put down terrorism. We all know what I'm talking about from what we saw on television about Sri Lanka. You can imagine the kind of people who came once they broke free from that terrible hold of the LTTE. We all saw pictures of it on television. It is war. War is always bad business. But in the midst of that, we saw people breaking free and running for freedom. But what was most amazing is everyone who came out of that siege never came out looking strong and healthy, and they looked emaciated, they looked horror-stricken, they looked terrorized, they had spent traumatic days and nights listening to the whistling sounds of bombs falling here and there, killing and maiming people. And it's not a pleasant picture, believe me. We're not talking about the blessing of a nation or the downfall of a people. We're talking about the curse of depending on the arm of flesh. Can I have an amen, please? The curse of depending on the arm of flesh is wrong promises will always breed pain. But look at this. In this place, a people had come to a place of abiding rest because the words of a godly king, whose prosperity they had known had come because of God's blessing. But look at the enemy's words. The enemy was speaking famine and thirst, death and destruction. Hath not the same Hezekiah taken away his high places and his altars and commanded Judah and Jerusalem, saying, You shall worship before one altar and burn incense upon it? The best thing about the victory you and I have is a victory that always comes when the enemy, after blabbering against us, starts blabbering against the God we serve. That's the most, or I can say the turning point in the victory that we begin to experience. As long as the enemy keeps blabbering against it, it looks like, you know, things are against us, we're being cursed and abused, and people speak so many things, but at some point they start speaking against God. And that's when God steps in, because God is always a covenant God. Look at what these people were saying. The Assyrians had decided this man, that means the news of what this man did had got to Assyria. And they were against the God of Hezekiah. That's why when you see an attack against your wealth or health, it is not actually primarily against you. It's against the God you serve. It's against the God you declare is the one and only true God. One altar disturbed them. Multiple altars never disturbed them. Follow. Know ye not what I and my fathers have done unto all the people of other lands, where the gods of the nations of those lands and anyways able to deliver their lands out of my hand? Who was there among all the gods of those nations that my fathers utterly destroyed, that could deliver his people out of my hand, that your God should be able to deliver you out of my hand? Now that's the place where the entire deciding factor begins to come out about the outcome of the war we face, about the attack we are confronted with. Can your God really deliver you? Can your God prove what he said to you and that you are believing in? Is it true? Can he bring it to pass? Yes, he'll bring it to pass. Yes, he'll fulfill what he said he will do in my life. Now therefore, let not Hezekiah deceive you nor persuade you on this manner, neither yet believe him. No God of any nation or kingdom was able to deliver his people out of my hand and out of the hand of my fathers. How much less shall your God deliver you out of my hand? I wanted to see something here. The track record this man had is amazing. Not one thing that this man said was untrue. His record was good. Everywhere he went, he won. But there's one place he went against, and that's the place that we're dealing with this morning. He underestimated the power of prayer. He underestimated the Cether of Elyon. How much more exciting the history class will be if we talk about a living God who answers prayers. Hallelujah. You give students what they don't know. The blessing of knowing why the man lost. Hallelujah. All the other gods of the nations were no god. They weren't called the Most High God. They were all local gods. So this man, with the arm of flesh, could destroy them. With human ingenuity, he could attack them at will and tear them down, make them nothing. But now that he has challenged the Most High God, look at what God had to do. And his servant spake yet more against the Lord God and against his servant Hezekiah. Now see how all of a sudden, till now the attack was against Hezekiah. Then he pulled God in. Now there is a role difference. No, it's not against Hezekiah first. It's against the Lord God first and then against his servant Hezekiah. That's how it happens in every man's life. They attack you in your office. At some point they'll start attacking your God. That's when God steps in. That's when the deciding factor about the outcome of that attack is actually begun to take place. Because sooner or later they'll come out of the wood in their entire mindset about the attack. They'll start attacking your God. They'll start attacking why he's an intolerant God. Let me put it like this. God, the God of the Bible, is actually an intolerant God. He is intolerant. Whether you kill me or not, he is intolerant. He never tolerates any other gods. He'll never sit along with any other god on the same podium. If he sits, he will sit always high above the rest. Can I hear an amen? You better believe it. He will always sit high above the rest. He will always be known as the Most High God. He will never sit in par with another god and say, let's have a discussion. Let's have a meeting. Let's have a dialogue. He never dialogues with other gods. He challenges other gods. He never dialogues with other gods. He's always on the move against other gods. Because he knows the gods of this world are the works of men's hands. They have mouths and cannot speak. Eyes and cannot see. Ears and cannot hear. Hands and cannot handle. Feet and cannot walk. And nothing can change that. He is intolerant. He'll tolerate anybody who has sinned. But he has an aversion for the idols of this world. And the time you get that into your spirit, not in your minds, into your spirit, that's when you begin to see God fighting for you. God doing things for you. Now, he wrote also letters to rail on the Lord God of Israel and to speak against him, saying, as the gods of the nations of other lands have not delivered their people out of my hand, so shall not the God of Hezekiah deliver his people out of my hand. Then they cried with a loud voice in the Jews' speech unto the people of Jerusalem that were on the wall, follow, to affright them and to trouble them, that they might take the city. Follow, how do they want to take the city? They wanted to take the city the same way you find people even today waging war first with words. That's why propaganda during wartime is always high priority for nations in war. Whether you know it or not, if you study world history and World War I and World War II and how the wars were fought, you will find that the Allies used a lot of propaganda by radio and leaflets to undermine the strength of the enemy. They are not simply distributing leaflets. They will guarantee safety to soldiers who would desert. They'll say, "We'll forgive you. You have already lost. You have only this much of power to sustain the war for this many days." Now, all this is no joke, especially to soldiers on the battlefront, for them to think within 3 days the nation will come to its knees. If the war prolongs, means weakening of hands. Now, that's what these men were trying to do. That's why you must spend time with God in prayer. Never give up on your prayer day. Never give up on your prayer time. Each man has a prayer day and a prayer time that is peculiar to his level of walking with God and hearing from God. You must spend time with God in prayer. Because the enemy's words are very real. It is to frighten, it is to trouble, it is to harass, and ultimately take the city. Take what you have. And they speak against the God of Jerusalem as against the gods of the people of the earth, which were the work of the hands of man. Now follow carefully. The key to how Sennacherib won is found in verse 19. I want you to write it down. Very often people don't even say that because they don't actually see the key there. The key to Sennacherib's victory was in the power of words that he used. Every time he went against a nation that was idolatrous, he said, "Your God is no God." And to tell you the truth, the God who heard it had no ears to respond. Can I have an amen? A louder amen. You hear people challenging you every day. They don't know your God has ears to hear what they're saying. They don't know that your God has a mouth to speak that will turn the tide of war. Because till now they literally use their mouth to speak against no gods. Gods who had ears but couldn't hear. So there was no response. And so they won. They spoke about that person, they won. They spoke about another person, they won. They spoke about this individual, they won. Because that individual never served a God who hears. Look at verse 19. "And they spake against the God of Jerusalem as against the gods of the people of the earth." He had done it successfully earlier. He had seen one nation after another nation fall. But thank God for the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. He's a living God. You're confronted with some situation that looks threatening. Let the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob speak for you. Let his word be the last word in your life. That's why he's called the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the first and the last. His word about your life will be the last word about your life. This is the key that most people ignore. In fact, I've never heard anybody teach me this earlier. How did Sennacherib win? I've always thought he won because of his army strength. That's how we always saw it. Which were the work of the hands of man. And they spake against the God of Jerusalem. He's always done it. He's done it earlier. He has massacred people earlier. He has destroyed people earlier, built a strong army of men. Somehow, he wouldn't win here. Because what he was speaking was against a God who hears, God who answers, and a people who sought the face of such a God. Now let's read. And for this cause, Hezekiah the king and the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, prayed and cried to heaven. I want you to mark that down. If you're desperate for an answer from God, you must learn to see that God is a God who answers your prayer. The gods of the earth cannot. That's why at some point, serious seekers after God will start looking for another God away from their religion. If they're humble and seriously seeking for God, they will find that there is no answer in religion. Sooner or later, in the wisdom of God, they'll stumble across some situation that will warrant them getting to know of the God of the Bible. That's when they begin to see a prayer answering God, a God who answers prayers. And the Lord sent an angel which cut off all the mighty men of valor and the leaders and captains in the camp of the king of Assyria. So he returned with shame of face to his own land, and when he was come into the house of his God. Because till now he was bragging about no gods of this nation, none of them can help, none of them can save you from my hand. Well, not even his God. Even his God was added to that bracket. They that came forth of his own bowels slew him there with a sword. Thus the Lord saved Hezekiah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem from the hand of Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, and from the hand of all other, and guided them on every side. Now look at the prosperity. And many brought gifts unto the Lord to Jerusalem, and presents to Hezekiah, king of Judah, so that he was magnified in the sight of all nations from henceforth. Now come with me to Isaiah, please. Because if we don't look at it from the record of Isaiah the prophet, it looks a little incomplete about what actually happened to this man, Sennacherib. We want to hear firsthand how God responded. Listen, Hezekiah was called a deceiver. Hezekiah was called a man who couldn't deliver on what he promised his people. Now let's see what happened in verse 37. Why the Cether of God is a holy place. And it came to pass when King Hezekiah, chapter 37, Isaiah 37. It's a continuation of what we see in 36. When King Hezekiah heard it, that he rent his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of the Lord. And he sent Eliakim, which was over the household, and Shebna the scribe, and the elders of the priests covered with sackcloth unto Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos. They said unto him, thus saith Hezekiah, this day is a day of trouble and of rebuke and of blasphemy. For the children are come to the birth and there is no strength to bring forth. You come to the place where you're going to have a natural birth. And then all of a sudden the mother gives up and says, no strength. I'm not able to bring forth the child. That's a dangerous situation. It may be that the Lord thy God will hear the words of Rabshakeh, whom the king of Assyria's master had sent to reproach the living God, and will reprove the words which the Lord thy God hath heard. Wherefore lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. So the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah, and Isaiah said unto them, thus shall you say unto your master, thus saith the Lord. What a blessing to know it's thus saith the Lord. Not I prayed and nothing happened. We have a God who speaks. We have a God who hears. Be not afraid of the words that thou hast heard. wherewith the servants of the king of Assyria have blasphemed me. Behold, I will send a blast upon him, and he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land. And I will cause him to fall by the sword in his own land. Now this is the God you see in the Bible. Why should he change today? In 2009, when you pray and cry out to him for deliverance, he'll tell you exactly the date and the time and the event that is to place. To take place, right down to the detail. He will die by the sword in his own land, not out of old age. So Rabshakeh returned and found the king of Assyria warring against Libna, for he had heard that he was departed from Lachish. Now we heard that Sennacherib had laid a siege on Lachish. We read that in 2 Chronicles. And he heard say concerning Tirhak, king of Ethiopia, he's come forth to make war with thee. Mark this down, please. And when he heard it, he sent messengers to Hezekiah, saying, thus shall you speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah, saying, let not thy God in whom thou trustest deceive thee, saying, Jerusalem shall not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Behold, thou hast heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all lands by destroying them utterly, and shalt thou be delivered? Have the gods of the nations delivered them, which my fathers have destroyed, as Gozan and Haran and Rezpah and the children of Eden which were in Telasar? Where is the king of Hamath and the king of Arphad and the king of the city of Seph, Harwain, Hena and Eva? Have you ever heard of those gods? Don't be frightened to laugh. 2 centuries from now, half the gods that our nation keeps blabbering about all the time, nobody will even know them. You're frightened? I am not frightened. Eternity is already sealed in my spirit. I know where I'm heading. I know whom I love and serve. Have you ever heard of these gods? Have you heard of the kings who trusted in them? The man was in wrong. They were worshipping idols. Ask is a God answers according to Psalm 115. He is a prayer answering God. And Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up unto the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. Take your attack to the house of the Lord and spread it before God. You brought some letters this morning. Somebody is threatening you, spread it before the Lord. Let the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob see what the challenge is. The challenge is not against you. Remember, however long we live, someday we are going to close our eyes and go. The next generation will come who will be still worshipping this God who is a God who is a living God. They will have the same attack. They will have the same slander, the same blasphemy to deal with. It's not directed against you and me personally. It's against him. So he must answer. In our generation, he must answer. The next generation must see him as a prayer answering God as well. 4 generations from now, if our children are still there on the face of this earth because Jesus hasn't come, they will have to face the same enemy who will slander the God of Abraham, slander the God of Isaac, slander the God of Jacob. But let me tell you something. He will still be a prayer answering God. He'll take the fight into the enemy's camp. And he'll destroy the enemy once and for all. Look at it. And Hezekiah prayed unto the Lord saying, he didn't say, oh Jehovah Shalom. Now hear you. Even in prayer you must know what name to use. He never used the word Jehovah Shalom. He said Jehovah Sabaoth. Oh Lord of hosts, God of battles, God of Israel, covenant God, thou that dwellest between the cherubim. That means angels bow in worship to you. Angelic beings bow in worship to you. Thou art the God, even thou alone of all the kingdoms of the earth. Thou hast made heaven and earth. Incline thine ear, O Lord, and hear. Open thine eyes, O Lord, and see. This is the difference between the God we serve and the gods you find on the face of this earth. Whether people like it or not, whether they accept it or not, this is the truth. That's why the three Hebrew boys would rather die than serve a God who had eyes and cannot see, ears and cannot hear. They wouldn't like to bow before the image of Nebuchadnezzar. They said, we won't. Because our God can see. Our God can hear. Our God is a living God. Whether he wants to deliver now or not, that's his choice. He can choose. He doesn't have to be carried from one place to another place and left. He'll do what he likes. He wants to deliver us, he'll deliver us. If he doesn't want also, it doesn't matter. We know we are going to where he is. We'll move to where he is. Follow carefully. Hear all the words of Sennacherib which had sent to reproach the living God. Of a truth, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations and their countries. So what the man's record was in the natural world was an impeccable record of a winner. But the problem is when you stand on the scene as an anointed man or a woman of God, you are the new winner. You're looking at the recent loser who's coming up against you and the God you love and serve. Of a truth, Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations and their countries and have cast their gods into the fire. For they were no gods but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore they have destroyed them. This is a biblical prayer. I don't hear you. This is a biblical prayer. You want a Bible-based prayer? This is a biblical prayer. Don't sit and get intimidated by uncleanness. You must know how to hype the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob so much that he starts moving on your behalf because you prayed and asked him to intervene. Now therefore, O Lord our God, save us from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that thou art the Lord, even thou only. Why should you experience a miracle? Because then the world will know your God is a living God. Then the world will know that your God is alive. Then Isaiah the son of Amos sent unto Hezekiah saying, so you can see two places what is happening. One, the king has entered the Cether. He is crying out to God. On the other hand, the prophet is receiving word from the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, whereas thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, this is the word which the Lord had spoken concerning him. Let's read this, because this is what God spoke. This is exactly what he's speaking to the needs of your life this morning. As the barley harvest is going to give way to the wheat harvest, get ready for miracles to happen. This is a prophetic word to you. Get ready for miracles to happen. Get ready for signs and wonders. Get ready for the hundredfold harvest. The virgin, the daughter of Zion, had despised thee and laughed thee to scorn. The daughter of Jerusalem had shaken her head at thee. Whom hast thou reproached and blasphemed? And against whom hast thou exalted thy voice and lifted up thine eyes on high? Even against the Holy One of Israel. By thy servants hast thou reproached the Lord and hast said, by the multitude of my chariots am I come up to the height of the mountains, to the sides of Lebanon. I want you to mark these words down carefully. Today you sang a song earlier. Children of Zion, rejoice. Why should you rejoice? Not because you immediately had a money miracle or a healing miracle happen. You're rejoicing because your God is at work on your case. Till he says over, it's not over. Till he says finished, it's not finished. No man can write your destiny. No man can write your destiny. Follow carefully. By thy servants has the reproach the Lord and has said, by the multitude of my chariots am I come up to the height of the mountains, to the sides of Lebanon. Then I will cut down the tall cedars thereof, and the choice fir trees thereof, and I will enter into the height of his border, and the forest of his Carmel. I have digged and drunk water, and with the sole of my feet have I dried up all the rivers of the besieged places. Hast thou not heard long ago how I have done it, and of ancient times that I have formed it? Now I brought it to pass that thou shouldest be to lay waste defense cities into ruinous heaps. Therefore the inhabitants were of small power. They were dismayed and confounded. They were as the grass of the field and as the green herb, as the grass on the housetops, and as corn blasted before it be grown up. But I know thy abode and thy going out and thy coming in, and thy rage against me. Isn't it amazing that every one of Sennacherib's victory was the wisdom of God in operation to dethrone the gods of this earth? God never for one moment or not for one instance lost control over any situation that Sennacherib was involved in, because he was actually bringing him full circle to the place where the god of Sennacherib, Nisroch, would be dethroned. So when you see pharaohs, and you see Sennacheribs, and you see Goliaths, and you see the annex of the land, remember they are all fulfilling the wisdom of God. At some point they will bow before the Most High God. The only person who will rule and reign supreme is the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Your God and my God. Because thy rage against me and thy tumult has come up into my ears. Now, because of your victories, you should have acknowledged like Nebuchadnezzar did. Or like some other kings did. The greatness of the God who blessed you. Instead, you have now started fighting against me. You have started speaking against me. Your victories have gone up to your head in such a way that you are walking in a lofty way. Therefore will I put my hook in thy nose and my bridle in your lips, and I will turn thee back by the way by which thou camest. I want you to see those two things. Hook in your nose, bridle in your lips. What does the bridle do? The horse can be turned in any direction. I have stood close to horses with bridles on them, in their mouth, race horses. I have heard the clang of metal on teeth. It will make you wince for one moment. Metal will hit teeth. Foam will be coming out from the sides of the horse's mouth. But that's the only way to control that animal. With a slight pull, the creature will turn in the direction you want it to go. Hook in your nose. You ever seen a bull being brought to subjection? Literally what you are saying is, like a bull and a horse, I'm going to lead you. That's why it's dangerous to go and worship bulls. It's even more dangerous to worship horses. God never takes delight in the strength of any of these creatures of his, except that they are part of his creation. He never wants them to become gods. He doesn't want the highest creation of his, man, worshiping animals. I will take you back by the way by which thou camest. Can you imagine? All the time Sennacherib must have thought, I'm king, I'm getting back by myself. It was God taking him back. Only thing now, bridled. Hooked. Once God hooks you, you're hooked for life. You're hooked for life in righteousness or in unrighteousness. That's why I told you, when harvest comes, it means blessing for one group of people. It means destruction for another group of people. Look at this, please. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall eat this year such as growth of itself, and the second year that which springeth of the same, and in the third year sow ye. I said 2007 will start off the sevens of God, the perfections of God. What year is this? We are in 2009. The third year, sow ye and reap and plant vineyards and eat the fruit thereof. So God is interested in you eating the fruit, not planting and no fruit. You plant, you got to see the fruit. You sow, you got to reap. And all this is spoken in time of battle. That's why I wanted to pay attention to what God is speaking this morning. It's prophetic. I feel sad for the ones who are not here this morning. They will have to hear it. Maybe if God leads me tomorrow to speak about it. You're getting it straight from the Lord. He's preparing you for the harvest. Get ready for the harvest. And the remnant that is escaped of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. You take root downward, you bear fruit upward. You take root into where you can't see, and then everybody sees the fruit you bear. The Cether is never known by anyone but by God. But when the blessing comes, it's public blessing. You look at somebody who never spends time with God in private, they're never taking root downwards. I wanted to highlight this place in your Bible. Root downwards, fruit upwards. Tell it loudly, please. Root downward, root downward, bear fruit upward. Take root downward, bear fruit upward. You spend time with God in prayer, you will see blessing come publicly. You read the book of Proverbs in private, you will see the wisdom of God in operation in public. You spend time with God in praise and worship, and you meditate on the word, and you do what the Lord asks you to do in private, you will see the blessing of prosperity in public. Too bad for the ones who get angry. Their anger will not stop your prosperity. What will stop your prosperity if you spend less time in the Cether? So you take root downward and you bear fruit upward. For out of Jerusalem shall go forth a remnant, and they that escape out of Mount Zion, the zeal of the Lord of hosts shall do this. Why will God prosper you? Because his zeal wants you to be prosperous. He wants you to prosper. He wants you to be in good health. He wants you to be productive. He wants you to be fruit bearing. He wants you to be people who will have root that cannot be shaken. Therefore thus saith the Lord concerning the king of Assyria. We're nearly through. He shall not come into this city. For people not to come into the city, you must say, they will not come into the city. They will not have any place here. There will be no alcoholic shops in this land. There will be no alcoholic shops near my house. You better say what you have to say if God is to bring to pass what he must bring to pass. He will not come into this city, nor shoot an arrow there, nor come before it with shields, nor cast a bank against it. By the way that he came, by the same way shall he return, and shall not come into this city, saith the Lord. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. David was a worshiper. David had got the promise. Now God's going to fulfill that. Now look at verse 36. Then the angel of the Lord went forth. History records that a strange plague affected Sennacherib's army. But it must be a real strange plague, for in one night for people to die so many. The angel of the Lord went forth. So if you're asking me, is the destroyer knocking off the firstborn in Egypt a one-off incident? No. I said no. It can happen at all times when people find favor with God. The angel of the Lord went forth and smote in the camp of the Syrians 185,000. So that's 185,000 people in one night. Plagues don't work that way. Sometimes the sickness has to run its course. But in one night, 185,000 dead. And when they arose early in the morning, that means while people were sleeping, they were dying. And this is not sickly TB patients. These are not cancer victims. These are not people who are sick. These were fighting men. Can I have an amen? These were fighting men in the peak of health. No sickness, disease till that point. All of a sudden in the night, the angel of the Lord went forth. 185,000 dead in one night. And in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. So Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed. The Bible tells us earlier, he went back in shame. He had no answer. And went and returned and dwelt at Nineveh. So Nineveh is not a Jewish place. Often when we read about Jonah going to Nineveh, we think he was going to some Jewish place. Part of Assyria. He went to Nineveh. And it came to pass as he was worshipping in the house of Nisroch, his God. Nisroch, his God. Say it loudly. Your God is not Nisroch, the living God. Nisroch was Sennacherib's God. Too bad for him. Nisroch, his God. That Adramelech and Sharas, his sons, smote him with a sword. And they escaped into the land of Armenia. And Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his stead. We're going to close with that. We're seeing the utter destruction of a man in his own place. That's how the enemy will ultimately get destroyed. Sennacherib believed Nineveh was a good, safe place to stay in. One thing we understand about Sennacherib, he was a small God-fearing man. Can I have an amen? He was a small God-fearing man. Small g before the God and the fear. No one said he was an irreligious man. Small God-fearing man. Most of them are. You'll see them with different signs of it. Some around their neck, some on their forehead, some on the wrists. They're all God-fearing, all a small g. You got to believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to get you out of the mess. And you got to believe the ones who put their trust in idols will come to utter confusion and shame. He went to the house of his God Nisroch. He went to worship. In the wisdom of God, God so ordained it that in that very place, not outside, in that very place, his own son should enter. Not some stranger. And they would kill him and let him die in a pool of blood in the temple of Nisroch. This was the man who was bragging, none of the gods can save you because none saved the ones who I went up against. Having known that, mustn't he have been a big fool to go to worship that small god called Nisroch? Maybe I sound a little crude and rude. But you must understand, for long, people have disgraced the living God. Made him look like he cannot do anything. No, he will do everything. That's why he says all things are possible to him who believes. Only believe. You come here with some need. You come with some want. You come here with some desire. You have your prayer list with you. Spread it out before the Lord. You got to believe that you're worshipping not an idol. You're worshipping a living God. He will answer you. His eyes will be open to your plea. His ear will be open to your cry. He will see what the enemy has said about him and you. Because when the enemy comes up against a believer and a Christian, the enemy is not mocking the believer and the Christian simply, apart from God. Ultimately, they want to desecrate the name of the living God. Don't let that happen. Have your prayer points with you as you bow your knees before the living God. Remember when Hezekiah cried out to God, Isaiah got the revelation from God, the answer from God, to the very minutest detail. One angel went up against an entire army of fighting men. 185,000 were destroyed. I want you to seek the face of God. And I want you to cry out to him this morning. Don't walk in a way in which that people get to think God doesn't answer prayer. God answers prayer. God is a prayer answering God. Every attack that comes up against you is to make God look like he's not a prayer answering God. He's a feeble God. He's a weak God. He isn't a weak God. I want to have people lifting up your voice and praying. I want you to worship him. I want you to praise him. I want you to declare what he believes you will do. Take root downward, bear fruit upward. Say it with your mouth, say it with your lips, and then bring forth your petition before God. You're not bowing your knees before me. I can't help you beyond the point. I can preach God's word to you, I can teach you God's word. It's for you to take your petitions to the living God. He's called the Ancient of Days. I said he is called the Ancient of Days. He will answer your heart's cry. And he will bring to pass the things of God in your generation. I want you to pray for the change of timings of the children's church. I want you to pray that God will anoint and bless the time that we have in prayer coming Tuesday, coming Wednesday, men's prayer. I want you to seek the face of the Lord, please. First, pray for the church. Pray for the house of God to prosper. Pray for the newsletters to come out on time. There's always such a delay with the Tamil newsletters. I want you to keep it in prayer. For God's anointing and God's favor. Seek the face of the Lord, please. Pray that the translation of the newsletter will be done because there's been some delay about that. I want to lift up your voice and pray. I want you to pray that God's anointing will be upon the ones who are working on the newsletter. God's favor. Last week I received a letter from a 70-year-old lady who's asking for a copy of the newsletter. It's the Lord's doing. Someone gave her a copy of the newsletter. She says, I want it. I want to read more about it. Please put me on the prayer list as well as the list for receiving the newsletters every month. Pray for the upcoming meetings. There are so many meetings that are on. Pray for God's prosperity during the time of the wheat harvest on all believers who are a part of the body of Christ. Respect what you are receiving from God. Acknowledge the time of the harvest. You will be a proud person if you don't acknowledge what God does in the natural world for Israel has a bearing on the spiritual Israel of God, which is the church. I want you to pray and acknowledge God as the God of the harvest. Pray for the people of God.
The ones who are here, the ones who are not here, the ones who will be coming in for the next services tomorrow, some who have traveled, some who are in town, and for the body of Christ as well, the church of God. Pray for a rich harvest of blessing. The wheat harvest, starting June 1st. With your mouth, acknowledge what God has taught you. With your mouth, ask for the blessing. If Hezekiah didn't ask for the blessing, he would not have seen victory at that battle. He would have been destroyed like the others were destroyed. When you ask, remember, you're expressing your faith in a God who answers prayer. If you're entering a new academic year, ask the Lord for wisdom. God will give you wisdom. If you're moving into a new area, if you're looking to God for wisdom to do something new in business, ask the Lord for wisdom. New direction. Because this is a new harvest. It's not a stale harvest, it's a fresh harvest. Coming June 1st onwards. The wheat harvest. Seek his face. Command the blessing. Lift up your voices and pray, please. Some of you are mumbling something. Don't mumble something. Start speaking what you want. If you will not do it here, you will not do it when you leave this place. Nobody is going to judge you. You want a miracle, you decree what you want. God will answer your prayer. God will back what you say. Because you will never rise above the confession of your lips. What is it you're confessing? That is what you will get. If the enemy is threatening you and intimidating you, then you've got to speak against that intimidation. Let the fear of the Lord take precedence over the fear of man. If you're getting ready for a trip to some place, well, ask the Lord for journey mercies. Pray for wisdom. Pray for favor. Pray for covenant protection. You're serving the Ancient of Days. In the mighty name of Jesus. Believe in divine destiny. Believe that God is at work in your life. Believe that you have been born for a time such as this. Believe that you're alive for a purpose. Look beyond what you see with your natural eyes. Don't be like a man who sees his image in a natural mirror. Then after he moves away, forgets how he looked. Start seeing with the sight of God. Begin to see what the wisdom of God is showing you about your future. About what God wants you to have and to enjoy. What your children must have and enjoy as well. About what the generations to come must have and enjoy. Look beyond what you see right now. Don't let the intimidation of the wicked one destroy your confidence in God. He is a God of miracles and signs and wonders. He is the God of the barley harvest. He is the God of the wheat harvest. He is the God of the double harvest, my friend. The double blessing, the twofold blessing, in the mighty name of Jesus. Mama Rabalaba Shatra Baharya. And as you pray, I want you to believe the Lord that your prayer points will be heard and answered. Some of you may be praying for some loved one, some of you may be praying for your own prayer needs. I want you to believe that the Lord will do mighty things. Believe that the Lord will do mighty things. Believe that prosperity will come. Blessings will be loosed. life partners will be made available for your children. God's covenant blessings will be upon them by day and by night. Command the blessing to manifest. Call it forth. Remember, Hezekiah had to speak comforting words to his people while the enemy was standing on the outskirts of the city, outside the walls that were repaired and rebuilt. This is a year of rebuilding. I want you to believe that the rebuilding will happen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Mamaraba Shatraba Labadi Rama Shaborobolo Horyantra Labariba Shabarabalabaharia. The righteous will be led into the Baraka of God. They will have to overcome the stench of war, to see the spoils of war, to enjoy it. Kabaraba Shamarabalabaharyantra. They will have to overcome what they've heard with their natural ears. The blasphemy, the slander, the filth that the enemy spewed out. They will have to overcome that if they are going to see the enemy go back by the way in which they came. In the mighty name of Jesus. By hook and bridle, the enemy will go towards his destruction. By hook and bridle, the enemy will go towards his destruction. I am speaking it forth in the name of the Lord. By hook and bridle. By hook and bridle. If you're a wise person, you will say it as well. By hook and bridle, the enemy will go back to his place of destruction. In the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. The plots of the enemy, the schemes of the enemy, they will not work. Mamariba shabara balabari antra bahoria, leberiba shatra bahari antra, shabaribo sikalaba. And this is the season of blessing. Whatever you are asking the Lord, open up your hearts and pour it out before Him and get that blessing in your life going. Get the blessing in your life going, my friends. Stop playing when God says this is the season of the blessing. Don't resent His words. Accept His words. Don't let the tiring things you have heard and seen tire you at a point such as this. Mama Rabba Shatra Baharya. The enemy wants to wear you down with his words and then take the city from you. He will not. God will not permit him to enter in. But you don't let him enter in because of your slackness this morning. Mama Shatra Baharya. Lodoroboshumaraba Sikhalaba. Idaramoshumaraba Sikhayala. Memeribo Shuprabha Labariantra Brahayala. Labariba Shatra Bohorya. Whatever you're placing before the Lord, believe that your miracle is on its way. Believe that the miracle is on its way. That the harvest will be enjoyed. Sowing, reaping. Fruit bearing. And the next crop are all what God is interested in. Don't forget what you have learned. Put it to use while you're on your knees in prayer. You're spending time before a God who's prayer answering God. He sees your heart's cry. You want a miracle happen in your life? This is the time to get it from the Lord. Get the word of the Lord. Get the word of the Lord. If you're seeking for direction, what to do next? Which company to apply in next? What must I do next? How can I invest next? Where should I invest next? This is the time to ask the Lord. He will show you. He will guide you. He will prosper you. Because when you invest time in His house, He will see that you prosper in all that you do. Mamariba Shatra Baharya. Rabalabari Anthrabo Shubara Hila Leberiba Shatrama Sikayala Shandarabala Bohoriantra Mama Shatrabaharya.